Hare Krishna.
Good day.
Hare Krishna.
Timbani.
Hare Krishna. Good day, Timbani.
Hare Krishna.
好的，那我们这边准备好了，您可以开始了。
Om Jnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chatsurun Militanyena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Vanchakaupatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhayevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Namaha Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prestaya Bhutale Srimati Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Sarasati Devi Kauravani Precharine Nirvisesha Shunyavadi Paschacya Deshatarine Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
So we're hearing about the interaction between King Rahugana and Jadbharat.
So we heard about Rahugana and Jadbharat, their dialogue.
Maharaj Rahugana was in his palanquin. And he was going to visit the holy place at the Ganga Sagar, where the Ganga, where the river Ganges flows into the sea. And he had recruited Jadbharat because he thought Jadbharat had a strong body, he would be a good man to help carry the king's palanquin.
这个加德巴拉塔就是为这个拉胡甘纳抬轿子的人，他们认为加德巴拉塔身体非常强壮，所以是一个适合抬轿子的人。
But when Jadbharat was carrying the palanquin, he was very careful not to step on any insects.
当加德巴拉塔抬轿子的时候，他非常的小心。他非常小心，不伤害到地上的任何一只昆虫或蚂蚁。
So this created a problem for the other people carrying the palanquin, and then the king also got disturbed.
但是，他给其他抬轿子的人就造成了麻烦，也给这个坐在轿子里面的 Rahugana 王，给他造成了麻烦。Rahugana 王受到的打扰。
And when the king found out that it was because of Jadbharat, then the king threatened to punish Jadbharat. He threatened to have him beaten.
当这个 Rahugana 发现这个事情的时候，他就威胁他说，威胁他，然后准备想鞭打他。
But Jadbharat surprised the king by speaking transcendental knowledge.
Jadbharat 通过讲述超然的知识，让这个国王 Rahugana 变得非常的惊讶。
Because Jadbharat, in his previous life, he had also been a king, but he had renounced the kingdom and he had gone to the Himalayas.
因为在先前的年代，Jadbharat 也是一位国王。但是呢，他放弃了这个王位，他去到了这个喜马拉雅山。
So while he was in the Himalayas, he had the experience of becoming attached to an animal, a deer, and the result was the next life he took birth as a deer.
当他在喜马拉雅山的那段时间的时候，他不知怎么的就迷恋上依附一头小鹿，然后呢，在他的下意识，他就真的成了这一头小鹿。
And after he gave up the body of the deer, then next life he took birth in a Brahmana's family.
当他离开了这头小鹿的躯体的时候，在他的下意识，他投身在一个婆罗门的家庭里面。
But he was very careful not to reveal himself as being a very advanced or very enlightened person. Instead, he pretended to be very foolish.
但是他非常小心地掩盖住自己，不向别人揭示。外在的呢，他显示得非常愚钝的一个人。虽然他内在很有这种觉悟，但是外在他显示为非常愚钝的一个人。
So this word jad means somebody who is stupid, who is not intelligent.
这个 jad 的意思是愚蠢的。
But actually he was the most intelligent, he was the most self-realized, most advanced, most elevated person, but he did not reveal himself to other people.
但是事实上他是最有智慧的人，最有知识的人。但是呢，他没有向别人揭示和展示他自己。
And he was walking around in a dirty condition, with his hair uncared for and his body dirty, but at the same time he was wearing a Brahmin thread over his shoulder.
他并不在乎他外在的这个躯体，很脏兮兮的，也走在一个很脏的地方。他在他的这个衣服里面还挂着一条圣线。
So when he spoke transcendental knowledge to the king was greatly impressed, and he was very worried that he had offended a great devotee.
当 Jadabharat 来讲述这个超然的知识的时候，这个 Raghugan 的王非常非常的惊讶，而且。他觉得 Raghugan 的王非常于这个时候呢就非常担心是不是冒犯了一位伟大的奉献者。
The king understood to offend a great devotee is very dangerous, is very harmful to our spiritual life.
国王知道如果冒犯了一位奉献者对于他的灵性生命是非常有害的。
And the king also knew that sometimes his great devotees,They don't reveal themselves, they hide themselves, they appear in like ordinary people.
这个国王也知道有一些伟大的灵魂他经常掩饰他自己，他并不向别人揭示他的灵性身份，就像一个普通的人一样显示在这个世界上。
Just like the four Kumaras are the origin, they're the sons of Brahma and they're the oldest in the universe.But they appear to be like young children, only a few years old.
就像主 Brahma 的孩子四库马尔兄弟，他们是这个宇宙中最古老的，但是呢，他们显现为一个显现为一些非常年轻的小孩，仅仅是四岁的小男孩。
Similarly, Sukadeva Goswami used to wander around like a mad person. Nobody knew his actual position.
就像 Shukadeva Goswami 有时候也把自己装扮为一个非常疯了的人一样，他不想让别人知道他自己。
So Maharaj Raghugana offered his respects to Jadbharat, and he asked forgiveness from him, and he asked to be forgiven by all of these great devotees.
于是 Raghugana 王就向 Jadbharat。寻求原谅他的冒犯，他也寻求能够原谅，祈求所有的奉献者能够原谅他的这个冒犯。
Yeah, Maharaj Raghugan knew that sometimes these Kshatriya kings, they become proud of their position, and they deal improperly with the great souls.
Raghugan 的王知道 在这个王室家庭里面有一些人，他可能也会对奉献者产生这种冒犯，产生冒犯这些伟大的灵魂。
But sometimes even these great yogis and great big gurus and sannyasis, sometimes they may commit offenses against the king, who is a great devotee.
但是呢，有一些伟大的瑜伽师，他们甚至也会冒犯一些国王。
Just like Maharaj Ambarish. Maharaj Ambarish was a grihastha and he was a kshatriya, but he was a great devotee.
就像 Maharaj Ambarish, 他是一个居士，他也是一个伟大的奉献者，他也是一个 kshatriya, 管理阶层。
And Durvasa, he was a brahmacharya, a sannyasi, and he was a guru.But he offended Maharaj Ambarish.
Durvasa Muni, he is a guru, he is a sannyasi, but he offended Maharaj Ambarish.
And he went all the way to see Lord Vishnu to try to get forgiven. And Lord Vishnu had to tell him, I cannot forgive you, you have to go to Maharaj Ambarish and get forgiven.
Durvasa Muni 找遍了所有的地方去找这个 Vishnu.希望威士努能够祈求威士努的宽恕，但是主威士努告诉他，你必须去找 Maharaj Ambarish 祈求他的原谅才可以。
So it was quite embarrassing for Durvasa Muni, who is a big guru and a big sannyasi, that he had to bow down to Maharaj Ambarish, who was a kshatriya and a grihastha.
这对 Durvasa Muni 来说是一个非常尴尬的事情。作为一个三尼亚西，作为一个气绝阶层，他不得不拜倒在安巴瑞什王的这个莲花柱下。安巴瑞什只是一个贵哈斯塔，一个查特里。
So you cannot judge the person's spiritual advancement just by external appearance.
所以我们不能仅仅从一个人外在的这种特征和情况来判断他的灵性的进步。
You cannot judge by the color of their cloth or by their ashram.
我们不能从他的衣服的这个颜色来，从他衣服的颜色以及他的 ashram 来判断他的这个情况。
So we have to always deal very carefully with other devotees.
因此，我们应该非常非常小心和其他一些奉献者相处。
So, Jad Bharat.Because, you see, Maharaj Rahugan, the king, he had threatened, he had spoke nasty words to Jad Bharat. He'd been very impolite and unkind. He spoke harshly about having him beaten. So Jad Bharat had some kind of dissatisfaction, bad feeling in his mind about this.
Because Rahugan, the king, had made Jad Bharat a serious insult.在言语上威胁了他，甚至说还要鞭打他。而这个加德巴拉特听到了这些，曾经对他的这些话有一点点不满。
Just like, you know, if somebody insults us, you know, we hold it, we have a grudge against them, we had bad feeling towards them.
就像有人指责我、辱骂我们的时候，我们对此会有一些很不好的感受。
But Jad Bharat.Is a very, very advanced devotee. He's a paramahamsa. He's on the topmost level of spiritual life.
但是加德巴拉塔，他是一个非常特别的奉献者，他是最高层面的奉献者，被称为至尊天鹅 paramahamsa 阶段的奉献者。
And although he could have had bad feelings, he didn't hold them in his mind. He was very kind.
虽然他有这种不好的感受，但是他并没有让此打扰到他的心意，他还是保持了平和。
Yeah, because he's a devotee, so he's very kind-hearted, and it's very easy for him not to be insulted by the words of the king.
因为他是一位奉献者，所以他天性善良宽厚，他不会因为这一个国王对他的侮辱。而改变他自己的情况。
So Jad Bharat told the king about the position of the soul, that we're all servants of the Supreme Lord.
Jadavarata 告诉国王，灵魂的构成性地位，我们都是主，都是主的仆人。
So then Maharaj Rahugan begged forgiveness again, and after that, then Jadavarata, he just said, okay, thank you, I forgive you, and then he went away to wander, just as he was doing before. Before they met, he was just wandering everywhere, wherever he liked to go, he would go.
Rahugan 的王呢，再一次祈求 Jadavarata 的原谅，然后这个 Jadavarata 就说，好的，我原谅了你。于是呢，他又像以前一样，开始想着想要去别的地方，漫游地球的四方。
Just like we saw Srila Prabhupada, before he departed from the world, he got caught, he asked his godbrothers to come and he begged forgiveness from them. He said, if I have offended you in any way, please forgive me.
就像圣帕帕德在离开这个世界之前，他把他的所有的神兄弟也召集了过来。他说，如果我在之前有冒犯你们的话，请得到你们的原谅。
Prabhupada told them, he said, sometimes in the course of preaching, sometimes we say things which are a bit harsh. So he said, if I've said like that, if I've upset you in any way, please forgive me.
Prabhupada 对他的神兄弟说，比如说在一些传教的时候，比如说我说了一些很尖锐的话语，造成了你们心中或者说对你们产生的任何情况的冒犯，希望得到你们的原谅。
Very important.Before we leave the world, that we should get forgiven for any of offenses we may have made.
这非常重要。当我们要离开这个物质世界的时候，我们必须向那些我们曾经冒犯过的人祈求得到他们的宽恕和原谅。
Right? Or if we still have some bitterness towards someone when we leave the world, then we take that bitterness with us into the next life. It's not good.
Sorry, Guruji.
If we have some bad feelings towards someone.
如果我们对于某些人还存在这种很不好的这种感受的话，我们有可能还会把这种不好的这种感受带到下一世。
So Maharaj Rahugan was very fortunate. He got special mercy from Jadavarata.And with that teaching, the king was able to get free of bodily concept of life.
Maharaj Rahugan 非常幸运，由于他得到了这个 Jadavarata 的涟漪和他，sorry, Guruji, I
get free of the bodily concept of life.
他从这个躯体化的这个概念之中得到了这个解脱出来。
To get free of the bodily concept of life means we have to become the servant of the servant of the Lord.
从躯体化的这个概念中解脱出来，意味着我们成为主仆人的仆人。
So, all of this was told by Sukadeva Goswami to Maharaj Parikshit. And when Maharaj Parikshit heard this,He said, yeah, he said, it's very powerful, very interesting.
我们所有讲述的这一切实际上是Sukadeva Goswami 对 Parikshita 王讲述的。当这个 Parikshita 王听到了 Sukadeva Goswami 讲述的这一切之后，他回答道，所有的这一切非常的有趣，而且非常有力量。
Said, you've told about the position of the conditioned soul.Is how he goes into the forest, just like a merchant goes into the forest to try to find something to sell.
您出色地讲述了那些受条件限制灵魂的这种地位，而他们就好像在森林中的这些商人。
So we can understand about how our senses are like, they're like thieves in the forest.
我们的这种感官就像在森林里面的这些贼一样。
And our wife and our children are like ferocious animals who give us trouble.
我们的妻子和孩子就像野兽一样，猛兽。
So he said, it's not very easy for ordinary people to understand the meaning of this story.
不是对于普通人来讲，不是特别容易的去理解这样的事情。
He said, you're telling everything by an example. He said, I want you to give the direct meaning.
您给出的这一些都是以一种比喻的形式给出的。我希望您给出直接的这种含义。
So now we're going to hear Sukadeva Goswami give the direct meaning of what he was talking about.
现在我们就要来聆听 Sukadeva Goswami 给出的直接的这种解释是怎样的。
So Sukadeva Goswami told Maharaj Parikshit, he said, just like the businessman is always trying to make money.
Sukadeva Goswami 就解释到，就像一个商人，他总是想着要如何去挣钱。
So sometimes he goes into the forest to find something like wood or even earth, and then he will take them to the city and he will sell them at a good price.
这个商人有时候会在森林里面找到一些木头或泥土之类的廉价商品。然后到城市里面去卖一个好价钱。
Yeah, he finds them in the forest, he gets them for nothing, but he takes them to the market, he sells them, makes a lot of money.
他在这个森林里面找到一些这种很微不足道的东西，然后就想到城市里面去赚一个大钱。
So in the same way, conditioned souls, ordinary people are greedy and they come to the material world to try to get some profit.
与此同时，这就好像这个受条件的限制的灵魂，因为很贪婪的想要进入到这个物质世界。
And we get affected by the material atmosphere, the material energy affects us, and we forget the real goal of life.
我们被这个物质世界的这种虚幻的这种能量给袭击和影响了之后。我们就不知道怎么样离开这种控制了。
He's in the forest, so he doesn't get association with devotees.
因为在森林里面，所以他并不很容易能找到奉献者的联谊。
And he's in the bodily conception of life, so he gives up one body, takes another body, continues in material life, one body after another.
因为他有这种躯体化的概念，所以他一个接一个的躯体不停地更换着。
Even sometimes he may go to higher planets, sometimes he goes to lower planets.
甚至有时候他会晋升到天堂星宿，有时候呢，他也会，降落到比较低等的星宿里面。
Sometimes he's a demigod, and sometimes he's in lower species of life, like an animal or a plant or a tree.
有些时候他可以成为一个半神人，但有些时候他也会成为一些低等的物种，比如说一些生物、一些植物、一些树等等。
So sometimes he's suffering very great, sometimes it's very painful.
有些时候他承受着很巨大的痛苦，非常难受。
But he tries to understand everything with his mind and senses.But this only causes him more suffering.
他想着用心意和他的感官去理解这一切，但是呢，又引发了更多的难痛苦。
So he cannot get the association of pure devotees. He doesn't know how to get the shelter of the lotus feet of Vishnu. He has to remain in the material life.
他无法得到奉献者的联谊，无法脱避一位纯粹的奉献者，也就无法得到威士努的这种庇护。
Just simply so much suffering from one condition after another, because he didn't have the shelter of a spiritual master, he didn't have any devotees to associate with.
因为他没有灵性导师的庇护，也没有奉献者的涟漪，所以他就在一个躯体接着另外一个躯体的这种轮回之中。
When one understands his suffering, we need to find somebody who can help us get out of that suffering condition.
当人感受到痛苦和遭受痛苦的时候，他应该想着我应该如何从这种痛苦之中解脱出来。
People may say, no, well, I'm not in the forest. I don't live in the forest. I live in the city. But the city is more dangerous than the forest.
有的人或许会说，我并没有生活在森林里面，我其实是生活在城市里面。但事实上，城市比森林更为的危险。
There's so many evils in the big city life. There's so many gangsters. There's so many dangers of being robbed or killed.
在这个城市里面有很多各种各样的危险，比如说有贼，有这种抢劫者，让这个城市处处都充满了危险。
And if you're working in the city, you have to wake up early in the morning. You have to drive in a lot of traffic. Very dangerous. Many people get accidents.
如果你在城市里面生活着，你早上得早早的起床，然后在高速公路上开着很快的车。但是呢，这有很多的交通的问题发生，各种各样的交通意外，非常的危险。
People often ride the motorbike to go to work because it's quicker than the car. They don't get stuck in the traffic so easily. They ride the motorbike, but the motorbike is much more dangerous.
比如说，有一些人他早上会骑着自己的摩托车去上班，因为摩托车去上班的时候就不会有很多的交通堵塞的问题。但是呢，骑着摩托车在这个高速公路上行驶的时候是更危险的一件事情。
Every day you see so many people in accidents. They have to go to hospital. They're injured. They suffer for a long time.
每天我们都能看到有些人因为交通事故而受伤，而不得不为此遭受很多天的痛苦。
And you have to live in the city. We have to live. There's not much fresh air. You have to live in some small apartment.
如果我们在城市里面生活的话，我们没有，并没有很好的空气，也没有很大的这个房子可以住。我们必须得在一个小房子里面住着。
Often you don't have any land where you can grow any vegetables for yourself. You have to purchase everything from the market.
通常情况下，我们也没有一个土地能够种植这些新鲜的蔬菜。我们这些新鲜的蔬菜，我们不得不到市场上去买这些新鲜的蔬菜。
And you have to live in the big building with so many other people.
我们不得不在一个高楼大厦里面和很多人居住在一起。
You don't have any real opportunity for privacy.
我们没有很多的机会拥有个人的隐私，就几乎不可能拥有自己的这种独处的个人隐私。
Sometimes there's no electricity, the whole building is affected, there's no power, no water.
有些时候这个城市停电的话，这栋大楼又没有电也没有水。
We have to climb up the stairs, many flights of stairs, you have to walk up the stairs, you have to carry the water up.
你如果住在很高的楼上，然后这个大厦又停电的话，你不得不从这个楼梯里面走上去，你还得从这个底楼拎着这个水一楼一楼的爬上去。
So many miseries are there living in the city. People think, oh, city life very nice, but actually a better life is in the countryside.
所以在这个城市生活是有很多的这种不便和这种痛苦的。人们觉得哦，生活在城市非常好，实际上生活在乡村才叫美好。
Now with the virus, people are appreciating more the value of having land and being able to grow their own food.
由于现在的这种疫情，人们现在越来越欣赏，越来越渴望，希望有一个自己的土地，能够得到他们的食物。
It's better to grow your own food and not to have to depend on other people for your food.
最好的情况是我们自己种的东西自己吃，而不是向别的地方索要一些食物。
So we need to learn how to get the shelter of the spiritual master to guide us out of this material world.
所以我们需要向灵性导师去得到他们的庇护和指导，我们如何离开这个物质世界。
The five senses of a conditioned soul are five senses that are just like thieves which take away everything from us.
我们身上的这五种感官也像贼一样，他们能够把我们的一切都洗劫一空。
So the same way the man goes to the forest and he is able to make some money, but then that money is taken away by so much sense gratification.
这个生意人虽然在森林里面拿了一些东西去得到了一些钱，这些钱，但是呢，这些钱马上就被这五种感官享乐给挥霍一空。
Because he cannot control his senses, so whenever he gets money, he will spend it on useless things like cigarettes and alcohol.
因为他无法控制住自己的感官，所以他一有钱的时候，就会把这些钱用于感官享乐，比如说用于香烟和酒。
Someday, they'll use the money for to women to cultivate women association with women and have illicit affairs with women.
有一些人也喜欢，也会拿着这些钱去和女人有一些联谊。
So it's not wrong to earn money, but we have to know how to use the money properly. Money should be used for the advancement of Krishna consciousness.
赚钱并没有错误，但是如果我们赚钱并没有错误，但是钱应该用于在修习 Krishna 知觉之中，为修习 Krishna 知觉取得进步而所用这些钱。
People who can't control their senses, they can't help themselves. They get money, immediately they have to spend it.
人们赚的钱，但是这些钱并不能帮助他们，他们有了这些钱，然后就花掉了。
And they spend it for so many useless things which have no value.
他们把这些钱用于完全无用的这些东西，事实上并没有什么价值。
Sometimes they're greedy and they gamble it and they lose all the money.
有些时候他非常贪婪，拿着这些钱去赌博，然后失去了一切。
And so Krishna consciousness is to train devotees to control the mind and to control the senses.
Krishna 知觉就在帮助训练奉献者来控制心意，来控制感官。
To teach them a little austerity and not to waste their money on foolish things.
来告诉他们来做一些苦行，而不要把这个钱全都浪费掉。
We like to see beautiful things, so we can see beautiful things in the temple. Go and see the deity, and you see the deity nicely dressed, beautiful clothes, beautiful jewelry.
我们想看美好的事物，那么我们就应该去到庙宇里去看美丽的神像，美丽神像穿的衣服，以及是美丽的神像他们挂的美丽的珠宝。
And the same way, when we have nice food, we should bring it and offer it to the deity.
如果我们有很好的食物，我们应该把这些食物用于供奉给神像。
And the nose is used to smell the flowers offered to the deity.
这个鼻子也应该用来闻供奉过给神像的鲜花。
And the ears are for hearing the Hare Krishna mantra and to hear the glories of the Supreme Lord.
我们的耳朵也应该用于聆听 Hare Krishna 这个曼陀罗，应该去聆听 主的荣耀。
But people only think about eating meat and drinking and having sex.
但是人们只是喜欢吃吃肉，然后从事性生活。
They get money. They want to have cars, and they'll use the car to go out at night, to go to club, and to mix with women without proper relationship.
当人们有了钱，他就去买车，然后开车兜风去到一个夜总会或者说俱乐部，然后在那里和这些女士有不正常的性生活的往来。
So the man, unfortunate man, he.Took so many risks. He worked very hard to get the money, and very easily it all goes.
这个男人花了很多的，冒了很大的风险，赚了这么多的钱，但是呢，又这么容易的，什么都没有了。
And even the man may have family, the family member like the wife and the children, they can be like wild animals, like a tiger or jackal.
即便这个男人他有家庭，但是他的妻子和儿子实际上就像豺狼和虎豹一样。
Right. We're not talking about devotees. We're talking about conditioned souls.
我们讲的不是这个奉献者的这个情况，我们讲的是这种受条件限制的灵魂他们的情况。
Right. We give the example, just like the man may be keeping many goats or many sheep.But then the wild animal, like the tiger or the fox, they will come and they will try to get the goat or get the sheep and they will eat them. Although the man's trying to protect them, these wild animals will come and they'll take away some of the animals.
即便这个牧羊人试图保护他的这些小羊羔，但是呢，人不免被猛虎啊、野兽啊、还有狐狸啊等这些动物给掠夺，一不小心，这些小羊羔就被给掠夺走了。虽然这个牧羊人看守得非常紧。
So even the man's trying to be very careful to protect his money, to keep it safely, but still the wife will find the money, or the children will come, they'll take the money, and the money will go, and the man's money very easily taken away from him.
那就好像刚刚我们说的，这个男人，即使他非常小心地看护他的钱财有可能还是会被他的妻子啊或者孩子一不小心就把这些钱财给挥霍一空了。
Yeah, during the day, the wife needs money for the expenses for the home, to buy things and to pay for things, and so she has to take the money for all her expenses.
白天这个妻子得拿着这个钱为这个家里的各种开支给去付钱，同时他也要去买一些东西为这个家里。
The husband had to work very hard, giving his own, shedding his own blood to make the money, but the wife takes it to spend it all.
这个男的非常非常努力的去，甚至是耗费自己的精血去赚了这么多的钱，但是呢，这个妻子一下子就把这些钱给用光了。
And then at night, then the wife wants sex. She wants to be satisfied. She demands sex from the husband, and in this way, she takes the blood from the husband at night as well.
在晚上的时候，这个妻子希望享受性生活，于是呢，她又把这个丈夫的。用精液化成的鲜血给拿走了。
Sometimes it's the children. They come. They want. They need money. They want this. They want that. So many things they need. The father has to pay for everything.
有些时候，小孩子又想要这个东西，要那个东西，但是这个时候，这个父亲就得为这些所有的东西给买单。
So this way, the wives and the children.They're just like thieves or pickpockets. They come to take away all the wealth of the father.
所以妻子和孩子，他就像这个贼一样，把这个父亲，把这个家里的男人的所有的一切给拿走了，抢夺着。
Sometimes the wife is described to be like a legitimate pickpocket, that she's not breaking the law because she's the man's wife. So the money he has, it actually belongs to the wife as well. So she has a right to take it.
有些时候这个妻子被比喻为古代
pickpocket, one who takes the things out someone's pocket, steals from the pocket.
把他的口袋里的那些钱给全拿了。
So,
虽然这个妻子她是合法的，但是她把这个钱给拿了。
So just like in, when you do farming, if you plow the field, then you uproot all the weeds.
当我们去种农田的时候，我们得除去杂草。
So even after you plow, then you, the although the weeds were uprooted, they will grow again because the seeds are still there, and again they will come up.
虽然我们能够把这些杂草给除掉，但是呢，由于那个种子还在土壤底下，它还会再一次给生长起来。
So it's important that people who have a desire to enjoy family life, they have to satisfy that desire before they try to leave the family life.
所以当一个人他在这个居士阶层，他应该满足于他的这个居士阶层的这种生活。
If they don't satisfy their desire fully in family life, then they cannot leave it. They'll have to stay there.
如果他不能满足于当下的这种生活，他无法离开这个居士的这种生活。
Just like if you have some camphor, you know camphor?
Yes.
So if you have camphor and you put it in a pot and then you burn it, so that the pot will always have that smell of the camphor.
就像在罐中有一些樟脑，虽然这个樟脑已经没了，但是这个味道还在这个罐子里面。
Just like the field, you plow the field, but the weeds are still there, the roots are there, the roots will grow, the weeds will grow up again.
我们去耕田，这些杂草，虽然表面的杂草能够除掉，但是杂草里面的种子都还在。
So therefore the desire to enjoy with the opposite sex is very strong, and if it's not, if this desire is not fully removed, then we will always fall back into the family life.
我们享受这种家庭生活的欲望，如果完全没有被清除掉的话，我们就又再一次会回到这种家庭生活之中。
Just like sometimes some people, they take sannyas. They maybe have been married, but then they take sannyas. But then after sannyas, sometimes then they want to go back and they want to get married again.
就像有一些人，他接受了这个气绝阶层的启迪，但是呢，他因为内心还有这种欲望，他又回到了这种家庭生活之中。
Even though it's very shameful to go back into family life after renouncing family life, but still, because the desire is so strong, they go back.
即便从这种气绝阶层回到这种家庭生活是非常可耻的一件事情，由于他的欲望非常的强烈，他还是驱使着这个人从三利亚省的生活中回到这种家庭生活之中。
So the only way to get rid of this desire is by fully engaging in devotional service.
而唯一能够去除这种内心强烈的欲望的方法，就是完全投入到对主的奉献服务之中。
If one is not fully engaged in devotional service, then he will be again attracted back into family life.
如果一个人不能全身心地投入到对主的奉献服务之中，他又会回到这种家庭生活之中。
So sometimes conditioned life, in household life, we become attached to money and property.
处在家庭生活阶层的人，他们非常依附财富和这种钱财。
But there's always so many people trying to steal from us.
但是也会有很多的人想从这个衣想从这个人身上那里去偷走一切。
They'll try to give us trouble, just like think creatures like rats come and they will eat things in your house.
就像有些时候这个老鼠会跑到你家里面，会吃掉一些东西。
And then mosquitoes come, they will bite you and suck your blood.
就像这个蚊子会跑到你的家里面，会吸你的血。
But still the man, because he's conditioned, he's still very lusty, and he still wants to enjoy material life.
由于他非常的这种充满了色欲，他仍然还想享受这种家庭的生活，虽然有这么多的痛苦。
He's thinking the material world is eternal. He can't remember it's temporary place.
他认为这个物质生活是永恒的，他并没有觉得这个物质生活只是一个短暂的地方。
Yeah, he thinks of it like seeing a house in the sky. You know, it's not real, but material life is like that, just like a dream.
就像在这个天有些时候就像海市蜃楼，或者说在梦中的这个情况一样，这不是真实的。
No, we are eternal, we're full of bliss and knowledge, but we're thinking the material world is full of bliss and joyful.
Sorry, Gurudev.
Where our spiritual nature is to be eternal and full of bliss.
我们灵性的这种本性是充满了这种极乐的。
But because of our ignorance, we're thinking the material world is eternal and full of bliss.
但是呢，因为我们在这个物质的这种境况下，所以呢，我们才会觉得这种物质的生活处境它是永恒的。
And in this way, we live in the material world.We enjoy eating and drinking and having relationships with the other sex.
在这种情况，我们就在这个物质世界里吃睡，然后性生活。
So it's just like the animal which is in the desert and he wants water. He thinks he sees water ahead, but it's not real.
就像这个动物在这个沙漠中行走的时候。他想追逐这个海市蜃楼。
So there are two worlds. There's the spiritual world and the material world.
有两个世界，一个是物质世界，一个是灵性世界。
The material world is just like the desert. We're thinking it to be real.
我们在物质世界里实际上是处在沙漠之中，但是呢，我们却认为它是真实的。
We're thinking there's pleasure here in the material world, but actually there's no pleasure here.
我们认为在这个物质世界里面有快乐，但事实上在这个物质世界什么都没有。
Just like the animal in the desert, he's thinking there's water, but there's no water.
就像这个动物在沙漠中看到了水，但实际上什么水都没有。
So you cannot find any happiness in material life.
我们在这个物质生活中找不到任何的快乐。
So we find this message again and again in all the scriptures, in Bhagavad Gita, in Srimad Bhagavatam.
这样的信息和哲理，我们一遍又一遍的在《薄伽梵歌》《薄伽梵谈》中找到。
So even we want to live here forever, we cannot do it. We have to change the body.
即便我们想一直待在这个物质世界，但是我们根本做不到，因为我们不得不改变我们的躯体。
Sometimes we become interested in gold, and we run after gold. We're trying to find the gold.
有些时候，我们想去追求黄金。
So, gold is, of course, people who have gold.Then they're envied by others.
人们如果有黄金的话，就会被其他人嫉妒。
And people who have gold, they're inclined towards sinful activities like meat eating, intoxication, gambling, and illicit sex.
而拥有黄金的人又会衍生出其他的罪恶活动，比如说赌博、乱性、吃肉和这种吸食麻醉品。
So people who are in the mode of passion, they're very attracted by the color of gold.
当一个人被激情属性所影响的时候，他非常迷恋金子的颜色。
Just like the man in the forest, if he's in the forest at night, it's very cold, and he sees some kind of light, and he thinks it's a fire, he goes running towards it.
就好像一个在森林中被挨冻的人，他想去找火来取暖。
In the Bhagavatam, we have the example of Maharaj Parikshit, who met the personality of Kali.
在这个圣典薄伽瓦坛中，我们看到 Maharaj Parikshit， 他看到这个卡利的人格化身。
So Kali surrendered to Maharaj Parikshit. So Maharaj Parikshit did not kill him. But
卡利他臣服了 Maharaj Parikshit， 然后 Maharaj Parikshit 没有杀他。
He told him, "You can only live wherever there is meat eating, intoxication, gambling, or illicit sex."
Maharaj Parikshit 说，你只能存在于赌博、非法性生活、吃肉和麻醉品之中。
But Kali said, then I don't have anywhere to stay because you're the ruler. You don't allow any of these things. So give me another, please give me another place where I can stay.
卡利说，因为你是这个国王，你是这个统治者，我根本没法在这些地方。中存活下来，所以请你给我一个其他的地方让我存在。
So Maharaj Parikshit said, "Okay, you can stay where there is gold, because where there is gold, then the sin, all the sinful activities will come."
所以 Maharaj Parikshit 说，那么你就可以在这个黄金之中存在，因为一旦有了黄金，所有的罪恶活动就会产生。
So in spiritual life.We're careful. We don't want to get too much involved with gold.
So, in 宁静生活中，我们得小心。我们不想和太多的金子、黄金，有太多的关联。
Yeah, the gold is color is a yellow color. So that gold is like another kind of stool.
这个黄金的这个颜色是黄色的。它和这个粪便的颜色实际上是一样的。
Yeah. If you don't have a good liver, if you're in your body, your liver doesn't work properly, then your stool may be all yellow.
有些时候，如果你的这个肾不太好的话，你尿的这个尿也是黄色。
So that color attracts materialistic people.
这种颜色就很吸引那些物质主义者。
They're attracted to this gold, which is just like stool.
他们非常被这些像大便一样的黄金所吸引。
So sometimes also we try to find a place to stay. We try to find a suitable home where we can maintain our body.
我们想在这个物质世界想找到一个舒适的地方来待着，想找到一个舒适的地方来维系自己的家庭。
Yeah, we need to have some, you need to have some water, you have to have some basic facilities for living.
我们想要一些水，想要一些基础的这种生活所设施。
So, just like we said, the man goes to the forest, he's trying to make some money,He's thinking he can maintain his body and soul, he can maintain his family.
而这个人呢，他认为他可以维系这个家庭。也认为他可以维系这个家庭。
He's thinking he'll make his life more comfortable, he'll make nice conditions for his home, it will be a comfortable place for him.
他认为他通过自己的努力可以让这个家庭让自己能够过得舒适一点。
But he forgets, the life is temporary. He's going to die. He's going to have to leave the world one day.
但是他忘了生命是非常短暂的，有一天他不得不离开这个短暂的这种物质生命。
And this way he falls into the illusion of trying to just be comfortable in the material world.
就这样呢，他在这种想追逐在物质世界舒适的这种虚幻之下被迷惑住了。
And sometimes he sees the beautiful opposite. He sees a beautiful woman, the opposite sex, and he becomes attracted.
有些时候他也会被一些非常异性的美丽所吸引。
Then again, his good intelligence is taken away by the mode of passion.
这个时候他的这个智性就被他的激情属性给夺去了。
Becomes blind with lusty desires.
他就像一个瞎，就像一个瞎子一样，蒙蔽了双眼。
And he doesn't follow any rules or regulations about having sex with the opposite, with the woman.
然后就违背了性生活原理而遵循的规范原则。
He doesn't realize that his sinful activities are being witnessed by many demigods, and he will have to suffer for all his sinful behavior.
他并没有意识到他的这种罪恶活动正被那些半神人们所注视，而之后呢，他要为这些罪恶活动而承受一些痛苦。
People don't know.They don't know the science how to produce a good child according to religious principles.
人们不知道，如何依靠这种宗教原则来生育一个好的孩子。
Sex is not wrong if it's done the right way.
性没有错误，如果它是正确的行为的话。
No, Krishna himself becomes that activity.When we use it the proper way.
如果是正当的性生活， Krishna 本身就是那种合法的性生活。
But conditioned souls, they don't know anything about this, and they don't even care to hear anything about this.
但是这种物质主义者，他完全不在乎这一切。
And he thinks, nobody's watching me, nobody sees what I'm doing. This is my business.
他认为没有人看到我，没有人知道我做的一切，这只是我个人的事情。
But they're punished. People are punished in this life and in the future for their activity.
但是惩罚的人在这个将来一定会等着他。
Illicit sex is very sinful, and people who do it, they're punished birth after birth.
非法性生活是非常严重的一种罪。这种惩，你会一世接一世的遭受这种惩罚。
Okay, so we will stop here today. Are there any questions?
好，我们今天讲到这儿，我们看一下有什么问题。稍等一下。Hare Krishna。
嗯，Hare Krishna，我们稍等一下。
好。第一个问题来自于 Jagateshwari Devidasi， 顶拜 Gurudev， 顶拜所有的奉献者。 Gurudev， 您刚才讲到，当我们要离开这个世界的时候，要求曾经冒犯过的奉献者的宽恕，那如果冒犯的奉献者不在跟前或不在一个城市，那应该怎么办？又怎样平时避免冒犯奉献者呢？感恩 Gurudev。So, Guru Maharaj, obeisance to you, obeisance to all the devotees. You talk about when we offend some devotees, when we leave this material world, we should get their forgiveness. But in this condition, when the devotees are not in the same city, how we can do? And how we can not offend devotees in the ordinary life? Thanks, Guru Maharaj.
Well, you can contact them on the telephone or on the Wi-Fi, on the Huixin. You can somehow write a letter to them and beg forgiveness. Somehow you can contact them, even they may be far away. What was the other case?
How to avoid not offenses devotees in the ordinary life.
Oh, we can avoid offending them by always seeing good in them, by always appreciating the service of a devotee and seeing the good quality of devotee. See, good. Be like a bee. The bee always takes the nectar. Don't be like the fly, which always goes to the sore.
Okay,
This
devotee ask whether the husband and wife their sexual sex is legal or illegal.
Well, in married life, there is also illicit sex. If the sex is simply for pleasure and not to have a child, then this is illicit.
当这个夫妻生活如果不是为了这个要生孩子的话，是不合法的，只是为了他们的享乐的话。
So we like children. You should, you want to have sex, you should be willing to have a child. It's not like some people do, they want sex, they don't want children, and they will take precautions so that they don't have child. They will use birth control devices so that the woman will not get pregnant. So that's illicit.
就像有一些人，他只是为了自己的享乐而去过这种性生活，不想让他的妻子去怀孕，而这种性生活是不合法的。And
sometimes when the woman gets pregnant and then they go and have an abortion, they don't want the child. That's also sinful.
有一些人，他的妻子已经怀孕了，他不想让这个孩子给生下来去流产。
So Prabhupada explains that the man's semen is a transformation of the blood of the body. The man's semen is a transformation of blood. It's his own blood transformed into semen.
圣帕帕的说，男人的这个精液其实上是血液的转换。
So, you know, when you lose blood, it's not very good for a man's health. So the man should be careful to use his blood to do something good with it, not to waste it. And people who are too much addicted to sex, then they will suffer later in life with bad health or some problem.
如果一个人很沉迷于这种性生活的话，这个人在以后会有会他的身体会不怎么健康。
So people should also you weaken your own brain by discharging semen. You lose a lot of semen, then you lose the power of memory. Good memory is lost, and the brain becomes weak.
当一个人浪费了很多的这种精液和血液的时候，他的这种记忆力也不会特别的好，大脑也不会特别的好。
So a woman wants to enjoy the association of her husband. If she induces a man to give her sex all the time, then she just brings about the early death of the husband.
如果这个妻子想享受这个丈夫，想跟丈夫一起享受这种生活，性生活的话，她只是在给这个丈夫，让他年轻就离开身，就是很早的就离开躯体了，就是让他短寿。
So intelligent people, they will restrain, they will not waste their semen. They will use it for the proper purpose to produce a child.
因此，一个智慧的人，他会很小心地使用自己的精液和精液，他会用它，他会严格地使用它，然后用它去生育一个恰当的孩子。Okay, good day. Next question from the Hanivamsa Prabhu. 让别人生气不开心，别人就和你断交，这算冒犯吗？ So makes others people angry and not happy, and then they will break your relationship with you. This is means offense.
Well, it may be an offense. I don't know. I would have to know more about what you did to make them angry and why it happened like that. Maybe you didn't deal properly with them.
我不知道你和这个事情，这个所说的这个具体的情况，有可能是冒犯。我想知道一些更具体的，你是怎么和别人相处的。
Generally, we like to have friendly dealings with everyone.
通常情况下，我们应该和别人很友好的相处。
It's easy to make enemies. We should try to make friends.
这个让成为一个敌人是很容易的。我们应该试着和别人成为朋友。
So we should always deal with people in a manner which is pleasing.And satisfying.
因此我们应该很小心地和别人相处，就是尽量地让别人满意，以一种愉悦的方式。
And Prabhupada always did that. He dealt with people and he tried to satisfy everybody, keep everybody happy.
Prabhupada 就是这么做的，圣帕帕德，他就是尽量地和每一个人在一起，让每个人都感觉到开心。
But if you make enemies, they can give you a lot of trouble.
但如果你交了一些敌人的话，他会给你制造很多的麻烦。
So you should be very careful how you deal with people.
因此你应该小心地和别人相处。Okay, next question. 敬爱的 Guru Dev.请问已经冒犯的奉献者不好意思当面道歉，自己在神像面前忏悔可以吗？ So obeisance to dear Guru Dev, I want to ask already offenses devotees, but I'm very embarrassed to apologize in this person. Can I just say some prayer in front of the deity?
No, not enough.
不足够，不行。
If you're not able to directly go and apologize to the devotee, then you have to try to somehow find some way by that you can serve the devotee.
如果你不好意思去直接找这位奉献者道歉的话，你可以找到一些方式去服务这个奉献者。
You go and you give personal service to him, and in this way, maybe he can forgive you.
你做一些对这个奉献者的亲自的服务，如此这个奉献者有可能会原谅你。
Yeah, we just said that Durvasa Muni went to Lord Vishnu, and Lord Vishnu said, I can't help you. Although the Sudarshan Chakra was Lord Vishnu's Sudarshan Chakra and it was chasing Durvasa Muni, Durvasa Muni came to Vishnu to save him. Vishnu said, I can't help you. You've offended the devotee. You have to go to the devotee and get forgiven.
就像我们刚刚讲的这个例子，当杜瓦萨穆尼冒犯了那个奉献者的时候，他去找主威士努，找主威士努祈求得到他的宽恕。这个时候，苏达善这个神蝶紧紧地追着这个杜瓦萨穆尼，但是虽然这个神蝶是主威士努手上的神蝶，但是主威士努说，我无法停止让这个苏达善追着你，你必须亲自去找到这个奉献者，祈求他的原谅才可以。
So you have to go to the devotee, and then if you're not able to directly ask for forgiveness for your offense, then you have to give personal service to him, and in that way get forgiven.
因此，如果你不能直接的去找这个奉献者当面道歉的话，那么呢，你就为他亲自做一些服务，如此可以得到这个原谅。
还有
，From the Vedavati Madhaji, Dimbai Gurudev 感恩翻译，在我家瓦坛中说，为了控制女人，向她说甜言蜜语的话语，怎么理解？也包括奉献者吗？A basis to Gurudev, thanks the translator. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, in order to control the woman, so should tell some sweet words to this woman, how to understand. This also include devotees?
Control some sweet words, tell some sweet words.
In order to control the woman, we should say some sweet words. Speak nicely.
Yes, it may be to devotee also. So you have to consider the situation. I don't know. But women devotees also would like to hear sweet words.
是的，也包括奉献者。有些情况是这样的。因为女奉献者也希望听到甜言蜜语。
We have to consider why you want to control the woman, what you're going to do.
我们要想一想，我们想知道为什么要控制女人，你准备做一些什么事情呢？
You want this woman to do something sinful?
你希望这个女人做一些罪恶的事情吗？
So we hope, if it's a woman devotee, you may speak words to her, she may be pleased, but it doesn't mean that you will control her.
如果她是一个女奉献者，你或许向她说一些甜美的话语可以取悦她，但并不意味着你可以控制她。
Good devotees are very careful to avoid sinful activities.
因为奉献者非常的小心避免一些罪恶的活动。
Okay. 还有问题？
还有，等一下，萨提玛的地正在。Okay. From Harini, Dimbai Gurudev, 经典中说，当我们处在躯体化概念中时，才会认为这是我的敌人，那是我的朋友。那我们怎样才能去掉这种躯体化的概念呢？谢谢 Gurudev.So, obeisance to Gurudev. In the scripture said, when we in the bodily conception then we think this is our enemy and that is our friend. So how to give up this bodily conception?
We're thinking the body is the enemy?
We think this is our enemy and this our friend.
Okay.
We distinguish enemy and friend.
Uh-huh. How to give up this conception?
Of bodily conception.
Well, we have to see everybody in relation to spiritual knowledge. We have to see everyone as a servant of Krishna, as a spirit soul.
因此，我们应该用一种灵性化的眼光去看那些。我们应该看所有人都是灵性的灵魂。
We are thinking friend and enemy because we're thinking, you know, this man did something to please me, so he's my friend. This man did something I didn't like, he's my enemy.
我们有这种敌人和友人有朋友的这种概念，是因为我们认为这个敌人会给我们造来一些麻烦，而那些朋友们会给我们造成会取悦我们。
But we should see everyone in relation to Krishna.
但是我们应该想，所有的人应该和 Krishna 进行连接。
Somebody did something which you didn't like. We should think, oh, Krishna must have told him to do this to me, just to help me to become detached.
虽然有一些人做了一些我们并不喜欢的事情，但我们应该想，也许是 Krishna 让这个人做这个事情，如此让我并不再依附这个物质世界。
When Krishna does, somebody does something which pleases you, we should think Krishna must have had him do it like this. Krishna must want to please me for some reason.
有一些人或许做了这个让我们感觉到满意的事情，我们应该也想，这有可能是 Krishna 安排的所做的这样的一些。
And so we seek that everyone is a part and parcel of Krishna and they are serving Krishna in different ways. So this way we should give up the bodily concept of life. Prahlad Maharaj was always telling his father, see everybody equally.Everyone, don't see friend and enemy, see everyone equally.
以刚刚我们讲的这种方式而变得去除躯体化概念，就像帕拉德马哈拉经常对他的父亲讲到，平等的对待敌人和友人。
So the demons, they make distinction like that, friend and enemy, but devotee doesn't think like that.
作为一个恶魔或许会有敌人和友人，但是作为一个奉献者不应该有这样的区分。
Devotee sees everyone spirit soul part and parcel of Krishna.
奉献者看每个人都是灵性的这个火花，是 Krishna 的一部分。
We don't think friend or enemy, that's not good to think like that.
我们不去看敌人、朋友，我们不去这样想。
So we have to chant Hare Krishna more and pray to Krishna to take away that bad feeling.
所以我们应该唱诵 Hare Krishna Mahamantra, 祈求 Krishna 帮我们拿走这种概念和不好的这种想法。
You have to see through the eyes of the scriptures.
我们应该用经典的眼光去看待这一切。
Don't just think on the basis of the mind.
而不要用心意的眼光去看待周围的一切。
Okay.
Okay. Next question from the Sati Mataji. 请问 Gurudev, 如果冒犯的奉献者自己却没有意识到，结果会怎样？ If we offenses devotee, but we are not...consciousness about this, what will happen?
Well, it can affect our devotional service. It can stop our progress in Krishna consciousness.
这个结果可能会反映到我们的奉爱服务上， 有可能会阻止，有可能会阻止我们的这个婚外服务的进程。
There are different degrees of offense. Some offenses are more serious than others.
有不同层面的这种冒犯，有一些程度的冒犯会很严重。
So if it's very serious offense, then it can disturb our taste for Krishna consciousness that we become more attracted to sense gratification, and we don't have so much interest to hear philosophy and to study the scriptures.
如果是一种很严重的冒犯的话，这个冒犯有可能会拿走我们在婚外服务中的品味，转而我们会依附这种物质感官享乐的这种品味。
There's a pastime that Rupa Goswami was meditating on the pastimes of Radha and Krishna. And in the pastime, something funny happened, and he was laughing about it.
有一个消息时光，就是 Rupa Goswami 他正在冥想 Radha 和 Krishna 的这个消息时光。当这个消息时光正在进行的时候，有一些很有意思的可笑的事情让他笑了。
So while he was laughing at that time, one man came by who had a very deformed body. And the man, when he saw Rupa Goswami smiling and laughing, he thought he was laughing at him.
当这个Rupa Goswami 正在冥想笑了一下的时候，刚好有一个人路过了。这个人看到 Rupa Goswami 正在笑，他就以为因为这个人的身体并不那么的好看，所以这个人路过的这个人他就以为 Rupa Goswami 是在取笑他。
So the result was, the man, he was upset with Rupa Goswami and he immediately left that place.
这个结果就是这个人看到。感觉到 Rupa Goswami 在笑他的时候，他感觉并不好，于是就离开了那个地方。
So when Rupa Goswami tried to meditate again on Radha and Krishna, he wasn't able to meditate. He wasn't able to enter into the pastimes of Radha and Krishna in his meditation, and he didn't know why.
而当 Rupa Goswami 再一次想进入到这种冥想 Radha 和 Krishna 的逍遥时光的时候，他进不去了。他也不知道为什么进不去，再进融进不冥想，继续冥想这个 Radha 和 Krishna 的逍遥时光，他不知道为什么。
So he asked his older brother Sanatan Goswami, and Sanatan Goswami said, "Well, maybe you offended a devotee."
于是他就问他的这个长兄 Sanatan Goswami, Sanatan Goswami 就跟他说，或许你冒犯了一位奉献者。
And Rupa Goswami said, "I never offended anybody. I never spoke to anybody." But then he remembered how this man was going past his house at the time when he was meditating before.
Rupa Goswami 就说，我根本就没有，我应该没有冒犯过任何人吧，因为我没有跟任何人有过交谈。但是呢，当他再一次回忆起这个事情的时候，他想着有一个人要。当时正经过他的家里。
So, he understood. This man must have thought I was offensive to him. So Rupa Goswami went to find the man, and he fell at his feet, and he said, "If I've offended you in any way, please forgive me."
所以这个 Rupa Goswami 回想这个过程的时候，他意识到了有可能我就冒犯了那个正经过我家门口的那个人。他于是就找到这个人。拜倒在他的足下，如果我冒犯了你的话，请原谅我。
And Rupa Goswami explained to the man why he was laughing, that something happened in my meditation on Radha and Krishna's pastimes, and I was laughing at that, I wasn't laughing at you.
Rupa Goswami 就向这个人解释到，当时呢，我在冥想的过程中，我为什么笑呢？是因为我当时正在冥想 Radha 和 Krishna 的逍遥时光，这个逍遥时光中的一点事情引发了我的笑，而并不是我在取笑您。
So in this way, the man forgave Rupa Goswami, and Rupa Goswami could meditate again on Radha and Krishna's pastimes.
之后呢，这个男的就原谅了 Rupa Goswami， 才能够再一次继续冥想 Radha 和 Krishna 的逍遥时光。
So we have to be very careful not to offend anyone.
因此我们应该很小心，不要冒犯任何一个人。
还有 question， 还有问题吗？
萨吉马德吉继续问道 ：“Gurudev， 您刚才讲到我们要非常小心，不要冒犯到奉献者。但我们在履行职责时，在履行管理职责时，并不能总是取悦每一个人。有时候会让一些奉献者高兴，可能也会让另外的奉献者不高兴或者是误解。这也是冒犯吗 ？”Gurudev， you just mentioned about we should be very careful about not offending devotees， but when we do some management duties, we are not always pleasing everyone. Sometimes make devotees happy, sometimes make the other devotees not happy and misunderstood. So this is also offense.
Well, you have to be very careful in dealing with devotees. It's very dangerous if they're not happy.
我们应该非常小心地和奉献者相处。如果他们不高兴的话，我们也是很危险的。
Just like Yamaraj, you know Yamaraj, he the god of death. So there was one yogi, he got one yogi sitting in a cave, and what happened? Some thieves came into that cave, and they were in the same cave with this yogi, and then the king's men came and they arrested all the thieves and they arrested the yogi as well.
在这个就是关于讲到 Yamaraj 的一个逍遥时光，在这个山洞里面有一个瑜伽师，有一个瑜伽师有一些贼，当这个国王来的时候，他就把这个瑜伽师和这个贼给同时逮捕了起来。
So they all got taken to court, and they all got the death sentence. The yogi also got the death sentence.
这个瑜伽师和这个贼同时被带到了法庭上。
And they were all to be sentenced to death. And what happened just before the yogi got sentenced to death, the king came and he heard what had happened and he understood that this was a great yogi and he wasn't a criminal, he shouldn't be arrested like that, it was all a mistake. So he set the yogi free.
当这个贼和这个瑜伽师都被逮捕起来送到法庭上的时候，他们被判处了死刑。这个时候国王就出面了，他看到这个瑜伽师的时候，他意识到他并不是一个犯罪的人，于是呢，他觉得这个瑜伽师不应该受到这样的对待，于是就把他给松绑了。
So then, when the yogi got free, then he went to see Yamaraj to find out why this happened to him. What did he do that this should happen to him?
当这个瑜伽士被释放了之后，他这个时候就找到了 Yamaraj， 他想到 Yamaraj 那去看一看，为什么他会遭到这么一个境遇的情况，为什么会有这么一出事情发生在他身上。
So Yamaraj told the yogi, he said, when you were a little boy, he said, you used to take some stick and you used to pierce insects with a stick.
Insects with the stick?
Yeah, you would take a stick and you would stick the piece of wood right through the body of the insect.
Oh, 他说当你是一个小孩的时候，你经常就会拿着一个棍子去挑这个蛇。
Not snake, insect.
一些拿着这棍子去挑一些虫子、昆虫。
Yeah, and you put the stick right, you know, a long thin stick, you put it right through the insect.
他把这个棍子放在这个昆虫要爬行的这个前面，阻碍他们。
So that the yogi, the death sentence, he was to be put on top of a spear.And it was to go right through his body.
Sorry, Gurudev.
The death sentence, when the yogi got taken to the court, he was to be put to death. And the method of putting him to death was to stick a spear right through him. to put this a big sharp metal rod right through the body of the yogi. That's how they would kill them. They wouldn't hang them. They would stick this big metal rod right through the body.
就当这个瑜伽士要带到这个法庭上要被判处死刑的时候，这个绳子只是在他旁边，但是当时并没有把这个瑜伽士给吊起来，是怎么着？
嗯？
Sorry.
Anyway, the yogi wasn't happy with Yamaraj, so he cursed Yamaraj.
无论如何，这个瑜伽师对 Yamaraj 非常的不高兴，他诅咒了 Yamaraj.
He cursed Yamaraj that he would become a sudra.
他诅咒 Yamaraj， 你将变成一个 sudra.
So he took birth as Vidura and came in Krishna's pastimes.
于是他就出生在这个 Krishna 的逍遥时光，成为了 Vidura.
So Prabhupada wrote a letter and he told the GBC, he said, just like Yamaraj got cursed because he cursed that yogi was to be punished. He said the yogi was only a young boy when he did things. He shouldn't have been punished. So the yogi was angry and he cursed Yamaraj.
这个圣帕帕德就给 GBC 写了一封信，他描述到当时呢，这个瑜伽士他应该是属于一个小孩，他虽然做了这样的一些淘气的事情，但他不应该遭受这么一个情况的一个人生中的一件事情。
Because when,
然后呢
when he did it,
他就诅咒了这个 Yamaraj。
When he did it, the yogi was only a little boy. Little children are not punishable.
当这个瑜伽士做这样的一个事情的时候，他还只是一个孩子。一个孩子做这样的事情，他不应该遭受到惩罚。
So Yamaraj got cursed. So Prabhupada told the GBC, if you don't manage nicely, you will also get cursed.
圣帕帕的就说，告诉这些 GBC， 如果你们管理的不好的话，你们也会遭到诅咒。
They have to be very careful to manage nicely to please everyone.
因此，你们应该很好的去管理，取悦每一个奉献者。
So it's not an easy thing to do, but if you make an effort, if you try to communicate with devotees and keep good communication and everything, then you can satisfy them.
这并不是一件容易的事情，但是如果你付出努力的话，你努力的去做这些事情的话，你可以尽量的去取悦每一个人。
But if you just think I'm the manager, I can do what I like, then that's not very good mood.
但是如果你想着我是一个管理者，我可以任其所能的做我自己想做的事情，这并不是一个很好的心态。
We're all equal in Krishna consciousness.
在 Krishna 智觉之中，我们每个人都是平等的。
We should work together happily.
我们应该大家一起团结合作，快乐的生活。
So keeping everybody happy is a very important part of management.
让每一个人快乐是管理中的一个很重要的部分。Next question from the.Haniwamsa Prabhu， 刚刚 Guru 的课程中讲述了世俗家庭生活是那么的可怕和罪恶， Guru 对我们的这些初级奉献者居士有什么意见才能够避免世俗家庭生活的苦难吗？ So Guru Dev, you just mentioned in the material family life there are so many terrible and sinful things. So, do you have some suggestions that for our devotees, how to avoid these material family sufferings?
We can avoid material suffering by taking up Krishna consciousness.
我们避免这个家庭世俗的这种苦难，通过来从事奉献服务。
All of the many great devotees, they were grihasthas, they were family men. They had families, but they were not in material life. They were not conditioned souls.
很多伟大的奉献者，他们都是居士生活。他们都是伟大的灵魂，他们并不处在受条件限制的生活之中。
Just like Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he was a fan, he had more than 10 children, had 11 children. But his home was the spiritual world.
就像圣 Bhaktivinoda Thakur, 他有着超过十个的孩子，但是呢，他的家庭生活是在灵性世界。
He said, Yadina Grehe Bhajana Deke Greheti Goloka Baya. He said, when I worship my deity at home, my home is like Goloka, like the spiritual world.
就像刚刚姑姑引述的这个世界，当我们崇拜这个家里面的神像的时候，我们的家就像 Goloka Vrindavan.
But if you're like Hiranyakashipu and your interest is only gold and sex,then your home is like the blind well.
如果我们像这个黑人羊卡西普一样，只是喜欢金钱和性生活的话，我们的家庭生活就像一个盲井一样。
盲井 ，OK。
黑井，黑井 ，black well。
Blind well。
Blind， 盲井。
Okay, so nothing wrong with family life if you're in Krishna consciousness. It's very good, very safe.
所以在这个 Krishna 知觉之中的家庭生活中并没有错误，是非常安全的。
Grihastha life is safe. Sannyas life is not safe.
Grihastha life 就是居士生活是安全的，但是弃觉阶层的生活并不安全。
You always have to move, travel everywhere, go around different places.
这个弃觉阶层，他必须总是搬家，一个地方接着到另外一个地方去。
But family life is very secure. You have a wife, you have a child, they protect you from sense gratification. They help you to control your senses.
但是家庭生活中，你有妻子，你有孩子，他们可以保护你免于处于这种罪恶的这种生活之中。
OK， 还有问题吗？
还有，冒犯世俗的人和修习奉献者有什么区别吗？也是 Hanumansa。So offenses the material people, and devotees, there are some difference. What's the difference between these?
There's no real difference. You should deal properly with people who are not devotees also. Don't offend anybody.
这没有什么区别，不要冒犯任何人，虽然他们不是奉献人。很好的和他们相处。
Krishna is in everyone's heart.So,
因为 Krishna 在每个人的内心之中
，so we offer our respects to everyone.
我们表达出我们的尊敬给予每一个人。Next question. 顶拜 Gurudev， 顶拜奉献者，把所有人看成是灵性的灵魂，是主的碎片，但是有人不那样看我。想尽办法想把我从这儿踢出去，这又怎么看 ？So obeisance to Gurudev, obeisance to devotees. See all everyone like as a spiritual soul and the part of the Lord. But others they not see us like this. They think they try to kick me out.They tried everything to kick me out. How to do and how to stay like this?
Who tries to kick you out?
the other peoples. We see other peoples like the spiritual soul, but others, they don't see me like this. They won't kick me out.
Well, we try to associate with devotees. You know, if these people are not devotees, then you don't need to associate with them.
如果这些人不是奉献者的话，我们不应该和他们联谊，我们应该和奉献者在一起联谊。 I'm not sure, maybe he said devotees, I'm not sure. If devotees want you.
No, if devotees want you to kick you out, then find some other devotees to associate with.
那么我就问，如果是奉献者怎么办？故就说，如果有奉献者想把你踢出去，那你就再找一些其他的奉献者不想把你踢出去的人和他们在一起联谊。
And if there are no other devotees, then you have to make some new devotees and make a new group, start a new group and associate.
如果没有其他的奉献者，那么呢，你就发展出新的奉献者，发展你自己的奉献者和他们在一起联谊。
Devotees of Krishna are everywhere. You just have to find them.
Krishna 的奉献者在所有的地方，你只需要把他们找出来就可以了。
Just start a group, start reading Prabhupada's books and get people to join your group and read with you.
你就开始一个小组，然后开始阅读圣帕帕的书，和他们一起，让他们一起和你阅读圣帕帕的书。
You're not dependent on others. You have to be able to use your own intelligence, how to practice Krishna consciousness. Don't be dependent on others.
你不要总是依靠一个人，依靠别人。你应该发展出自己的这个小组。
Practice Krishna consciousness is, you know, it's a science. You know, you should know how to do it. You have to learn how to do it. You see other people do it, you have to do it yourself.
Krishna 知觉修习是一门科学。你看到别人在做这个事情，你也得自己尝试去做这些事情。
Don't be attached to one particular situation. If they don't want you in that situation, you should think this is Krishna's plan. Krishna wants me to go and make a new group and start some other place.
不要太依附于一种特定的情况。如果有人不希望你在那儿，你就自己独立出去，去发展出你自己的这个小组。你要想，或许是 Krishna 希望我自己去独立发展一个小组。
还有问题吗？
目前没有看到了。
没有了，
不对。OK. So we'll stop here today.
好，我们今天到这儿。谢谢姑姑。
谢谢 ，Subodhi. Thank you very much.
谢谢你，顶拜你姑姑。
顶拜，顶拜，顶拜，所有的奉献者。
哎，
安宁，
晚安，
晚安，晚安，晚
安。
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.